Oh, hi there. Jordan with Motion Array, and looks like you just caught me browsing motionarray.com while also looking at images of my adorable cat and video chatting with my wife.
Stop calling me. If you call me again, I'm gonna call the police.
It's actually not a touchscreen. And I'm pretty sure you realize that wasn't me actually cycling through those images. It was all added in post-production. There's a lot of different reasons why you would actually need to replace a screen inside of After Effects. Maybe you don't have the graphics ready ahead of time. Or maybe you're on set and you just can't get the screen to look right. Or maybe getting the timing down perfectly is just too complicated. Whatever your reason, we're gonna show you how to do an After Effects screen replacement. And we're gonna start with a screen that's not moving and then move on to a screen where you're gonna need to track it all in post. But let's jump right into this effect.
So here we are inside of After Effects, and the first thing that we're going to do is bring the footage in here that we want to work with. Our example here is a shot from Motion Array's library, and you can find the link in the description below. It's a person with their tablet on a table, and they're swiping through some imaginary images. Step one is simple. Take your footage and trim it down to only what you're going to be using. We're going to be adding some effects in that will make After Effects work pretty hard, so the less unnecessary frames you have to render, the better. If you're not sure if your decision on how much footage you'll use will end up working, just use the B and N keys to set your in and out points and work with that. So for us, our usable footage looks like this. So now what we're going to do is create a composition that'll double as the screen so that we can line everything up nicely to start with. Create a new composition by going to Composition, New, Composition, and this will act as the screen of the tablet. I went ahead and looked up the dimensions of the particular tablet used in the shot, but even just an approximation will do if you're not 100% sure. I found that the dimensions were 1024 by 768, but it's vertical, so it's actually 768 by 1024. You might have to also uncheck the lock aspect ratio to make this work. Name it so that you'll remember it's the screen composition and hit OK. Cool, now this is what should appear on your screen. We're going to be adding a solid here that will contrast green pretty easily. Right click down here and go to New, Solid. And then we're going to click the swatch here and choose a red color. Now go back to your main composition and let's drag your screen composition that you just created into your main project. Next, we're going to line up the screen composition so that it matches the actual screen of the tablet. We need to add a corner pin effect. Go to your effects panel and search for it, and then drag and drop it onto your composition layer. When it's highlighted, you should be able to see these dots on the corners of your layer. If not, make sure that the layer controls are checked by going to View, Show Layer Controls. Drag the corners to roughly the screen position at first, then when they're closer, you can go in and do a fine-tune job. And it'll help for you to drop the opacity of your screen composition, so that you can see both at the same time. Get as close as you can, and then I'd suggest scaling up ever so slightly so that it's just a tad larger than the actual screen. A little too big is better than too small. Then bring your opacity back up, and this is what you have. Now go into your composition for your screen, and this is where you decide what's actually going to be on your screen. For me, it's this picture of a dog. Drag it in above your solid layer, and then resize it to fit your composition nicely. Whatever you see here is whatever you're going to actually be able to see on the screen. And then just hide your solid layer instead of deleting it, just in case we need to do some readjustments later. You can also add a video if you like, and it'll work exactly the same. But just for simplicity, and because our example is portrait, I'll work with this still image for now. But when we go forward here, we can see that we have a problem. Our finger goes beneath the picture of the dog. So there's two main methods that you can use to fix this. One is you can keep the photo on top and rotoscope the finger out of each individual frame. That's not the method that we're going to be using, but if you wanted a quick touch-up on rotoscoping, check out this video here that we did, and the link to it is in the description below. If you're using that rotoscope method, then you can join back in once you finish up rotoscoping, but for this example, what we're going to do is take advantage of the fact that the tablet has a green screen, and we're literally going to work with it as if it was a green screen. So drop the screen composition below your footage, And now, let's search for the key light effect. Drag it onto the footage layer that has the tablet. Click the eyedropper tool here to choose the actual color of the screen, and just click on the screen of the tablet. And with just one click, you can see that it doesn't do too bad of a job. But there's a couple problems that we need to address. First, our green didn't entirely key out, as there was some strange glare and banding left over. And then there's also some blur on the finger as it moves through the image. So let's take care of both of those. Go to the view and set it to screen matte. And now you should be able to see a black and white representation. Black is transparent and white is opaque. You want to focus on the screen for now and just make the screen completely black. So go down to the matte options and move the clip black slider until it's completely black and there's no banding. Now take the whites down until it becomes a lot better out here on the outside of the screen. In this case, you don't have to worry so much about the outside because we're going to be isolating the screen in just a second. But in other cases of green screening, it's always a great idea to make sure everything is as black and white as possible. Great! Now let's view our final result, and we can see that it's looking better. But it's still not amazing, especially here with the finger. There's some decoloration when it gets blurry moving from right to left. So let's go into another view mode. Status. Here we can see that we actually didn't get the screen completely keyed out, so let's keep raising the blacks and get our screen completely black. Then we notice that our finger here has a gray fringe around it, especially when it's wiping across. This is that motion blur we looked at before, and it makes it a little bit tough for key light to do its thing. So we're going to go back and keep playing with the clip black and clip white until we get to a place where we reduce the gray around the finger, but we don't take away the actual realistic blur. It's a happy medium, and it's going to take a little bit of trial and error. But if you're using the same clip as me for a reference, I found that to clip the blacks at 64 and the whites at 92 works really nice. And this is our final result. It's looking pretty great. But there's one thing that it looks like we missed. In taking away the green from our screen, we also took away the green out of the plant here, as well as the pens. So how do we isolate this screen only? Let's make a mask by highlighting the actual footage layer and then hitting Q to bring up our rectangle tool. Then click and drag over the screen. It doesn't have to be perfect, just so that it captures all of the screen and excludes any other green elements. Now go to your mask in your layer and set it to none. So right now we've created a mask that's not active. But we can tell our key light effect to use it by going to Inside Mask and choosing our Mask 1, and then hit Invert. Now our greens outside the mask are returned, and we can still key out the screen. And guys, this is our effect. It's actually working so that it looks a lot like the screen is actually projecting this image. But let's take it one quick step further by animating our picture off screen. Go to the first point of contact that the finger makes here with the tablet. And now when you dive into your screen comp, your playhead should be at the same place as in your previous composition. So set a keyframe for position and then go back. And now move forwards to the place where you want your image to be fully off screen. And then dive back into your screen composition and add a keyframe for your image off screen. Nice. Now let's see what that looks like. If you want to view that section on repeat, just use your B and N keys respectively to set in and out points and watch your footage on a loop. It's a start, but we need to make it look a little bit more realistic. So let's go back to our keyframes and highlight them and add an easy ease. It's getting better. And if you really wanted to finesse it, you can highlight your keyframes and then open up the graph editor. From here, you can tweak your motion to perfection. But the last thing that's really going to sell this effect is to add a finishing touch by going to our motion blur option and selecting it, and then enabling it for the image layer in specific. And if we place another image behind this one, it looks like that person is scrolling through images, and adds a little bit of realism. And so this is what we get for our final result. But if you study this image in depth, you can pick out that it's a little too perfect to be projected from a screen being recorded. In a pinch, this would be good enough, but let me show you two more things that will really help to sell the effect. First, add a realistic blur by searching for camera lens blur. Add it to your screen composition and only blur it out by a really, really subtle amount, like only 1 to 2 pixels of blur. If you don't do this, it's like assuming that your screen was recorded in perfect focus on an amazingly expensive lens. The second piece might also not be as intuitive. Go to your comp of your screen and let's add a white solid on top. Then, let's create a mask for a solid that's going to represent some fake screen glare from an off-camera light source, cutting across only part of the screen. Now, add a subtle feather to it and drop down the opacity really low, like below 25%. Do some minor touch-ups to what you think would make it look realistic. And now, when we take a look at the final image, we can see that there's a lot more of a realistic look to our screen. It's subtle, but it makes the whole thing feel a lot more real. And guys, that's how you do a screen replacement for a screen that's not moving. But what if your screen is moving? Let's dive into our second example and check that out. Okay, so here we have a woman who's on her phone, and it's moving around in her hand. To make any sort of screen replacement actually work, we need to track the movement of our screen exactly. Now, if you can see all the corners of your screen, a traditional perspective corner pin track could work. And we did a video on tracking objects using After Effects built-in tracker, and the link to that video is in the description below if you want to learn more about using it. But when we tried doing a corner pin track on our footage, we noticed that it was very easy to be disturbed by the woman's hand here interacting with the phone. So instead, we're going to be using an incredibly powerful tracker that comes with After Effects. It's called Mocha, and we're going to be walking through it step by step together to see how to use it. It's actually easier than you'd expect, so let's go through it together. With your footage on your timeline, go up to Animation, and track in Mocha AE. And Mocha should recognize the footage and automatically set up your composition for you. But there is the rare occasion that it doesn't recognize what you want to bring in. If that's the case, what's probably happening is that your footage format isn't able to be recognized. So an easy solution is just to take the footage as it was in After Effects and just export it as an H.264 format. This is one that Mocha will read very easily. And then just bring it back onto your timeline and keep going with our next steps. With your footage on the new Mocha timeline here, we're just going to be doing a couple of simple steps. Bring your footage playhead to the very start. Then click the X-Spline tool. And now, like the Pen tool in After Effects, click and make a basic shape around the screen of your phone. As long as the object with the screen is within the confines of your mask, it's pretty good at doing the rest of the work for you. You're just telling Mocha where to look, and the rough shape of your object. Once you've finished that last dot, hit the right mouse button to complete your outline. Great, you're actually almost done. But before we track, we're just going to make things a lot easier for After Effects later on. Go to this tool here called the Show Planar Surface, and click it. Now a box comes up, and you're just going to use this to tell Mocha exactly where the screen of your phone is. Just click and drag these corners here and try to get it as exact as possible. Up in the top left corner when you move it around, you should get a zoomed in view to help you be extra super accurate. This last corner we'll just have to estimate by using the parallel lines here and to get the borders as close as possible to the existing borders of the phone. Great, you're all done. So go down to this track forward button and click it to let Mocha do the work for you. It'll take a little while, so you can take a break for the meantime and come back in a few minutes. But while you're watching it track, what you should notice is that even interactions like the hand moving across the mask won't interrupt it at all. That's because you've specified the overall shape of the phone and the planar surface of the phone, so the track is going to be incredibly precise and should stick very well. Now that that's done, you just need to tell After Effects the data that Mocha just collected. So to do that, we're basically going to copy and paste the findings into After Effects. go to Export Tracking Data and choose the option with After Effects Corner Pin Supporting Motion Blur. And then when you hit Copy to Clipboard, you've basically just copied a bunch of information, and the next time you paste, it'll paste that information that Mocha just collected. So go back to After Effects, and let's just quickly set up a new solid to double as the screen. Right-click here, and go to New, Solid. Let's make it yellow so that it's really easy to contrast with the blue of the phone. Cool. Now let's pre-compose this, and label it so that we know it's our screen composition. Now we need to bring our playhead all the way back to the start. This is because the Mocha data was measured from the first frame. Now, when we go down to our transform properties of our screen composition and highlight it, and then hit Control or Command V to paste, all of our tracking data should now be pasted to the composition with the yellow solid. And you can play your footage and see that it's sticking incredibly well. It's lined up perfectly to our phone screen. And guys, that's honestly the only part that's different from our previous still tablet example. From here, we're just gonna blaze through the same process that we did for the still tablet because we don't have to worry about the jiggling motion now. So let's add in our video here on our screen layer. Drop the screen layer below our footage layer. Add the key light effect. Key out the blue. Mask around the screen. Set the mask to key light. Tweak the blue key, and animate our footage to be a little bit more engaging, making sure to enable motion blur. And top it all off with a lens blur and a little bit of fake screen glare.
And guys, that's how you replace a screen in After Effects. I hope you found this video helpful. If you did,
hey, what's up, Andrew Kramer.
We've got lots of other tutorials on After Effects over at motionarray.com.
And if you guys wanted to use any of the stock screen videos in this tutorial, we've got links to all of those, as well as a list of even more stock screen videos in the description below.
And make sure to subscribe to our channel and click the bell icon so that you never miss whenever we post.
Thanks so much for watching, and I can't wait to see you in the next video.